Hello friends, Heidi here from Rain Country. God is good all the time. Well, I'm finally getting around to harvesting my rhubarb. I'm really behind and I don't know what day this video is going to publish, but today is actually May 20th and it's been ready for a while. I've just been so incredibly busy. So I thought, man, I got to get started on this because there's still tons more out there and you really don't want to over harvest your rhubarb all at once. You want to take a few of the canes or stalks at a time from each plant. And so I try to limit myself and give the plants a few days and then harvest some more. So I've already got some chopped up. My favorite way to preserve my rhubarb actually is to freeze it. And so I simply store it. I just throw it into pint jars like this because it's rare I'd ever need more than a pint at a time. So I chop it up and toss it in there. And because of what I'm going to be doing, I don't want to pack it in there tight. I want to toss it in there loosely. And since this is mostly going to be used, the ones that I freeze like this, in making the creamsicles for Mr. Rain, usually I'll mix it in with blueberry or some other kind of fruit that's not quite so tart. So that will bring out the flavor of that other fruit, plus add a lot more vitamin C. And by freezing it, I can keep it raw, as well as it's very, once it's thawed out, it doesn't take long to thaw. It's very easy just to open up the jar, throw it into the blender with whatever other fruit that I'm going to be mixing with it. So keeping it kind of loose, I don't want it too close up to the top, because there's one thing different about the freezing method I'm using than I've done in previous years. So I'm gonna take a recycled canning lid, and I try not to, though I clean the lids, I don't scrub the lids like with a scrubber to get the ink off. I use rubbing alcohol instead, and I don't worry about it until I'm ready to reuse the lid. So this lid has been used many times, and the reason I don't like to scrub it, like this one I can tell has been scrubbed, has tiny little scratches in it, and you can see some of the original ink that never did come off. And that's why when you scrub it and with like any kind of scrubber, it's going to leave scratches. So when you go to reuse it, it gets harder and harder to get that ink off of there. So I just wash it with a regular dishcloth. Whatever doesn't come off, I don't worry about it, because then I just spray it off with the rubbing alcohol and wipe it with a dry cloth. You got to do it right away though. And yes, you can use a dry erase marker too, but having some isopropyl alcohol on hand just to spray a little bit on there is actually, to me, a little more cost effective, because dry erase markers are expensive. So here's the step that's different that I was too afraid to do until this year, and I finally tried it with some stinging nettle, because I did find out that other people do this. So as long as your stuff is packed loosely and it's not a liquid, this should work just fine. So I'm going to actually vacuum seal the jar, and that way it will also prevent freezer burn. So I'm gonna pump this up to about 15 or 400, actually a little past that, because this is the old brake bleeder. It's had almost 4 years of heavy use, and so it's not quite calibrated like it used to be. So I just go sometimes all the way up to 500, but I also go by how it feels. And right here, it feels ready. I don't even have to look at the number. And I think I heard it ping. Sometimes you'll hear it ping. Then I'm going to put my lid on there. And then I'll go ahead and write on here what it is and the date. And that will go on my freezer. Now, because this is loosely packed, it will expand a little bit, but it's got enough space in there. I don't have to worry about it breaking my jar. But if you don't want to vacuum seal it because it makes you nervous, you can do, my old method was, when it comes to anything, was just to put the lid on loosely until it's totally frozen and then tighten it down. However, this should not be a problem. Like I said, I tried it with my stinging nettle, wasn't a problem. I've heard about other people doing this. So when you're talking about things that are packed loosely in a jar like this, it shouldn't be an issue. Now, if we're talking liquids, no, I wouldn't vacuum seal it. I only fill it up to here. I wait until the liquid is totally frozen before I tighten down the lid. I leave space for it to expand. I've done that with turkey broth and with milk. Those are the two main liquids that I would freeze in jars. And then what I do to keep the jar safe, there's so many options. You can make yourself little bags. You can use old socks that you don't wear anymore if you have socks big enough to fit around these jars. Or what I like to do is just take, I just rip strips of old flannel. When we go garage selling, if we find any flannel whatsoever that's in decent shape, it doesn't matter what it looks like, we grab it because it has so many many uses. Most of the time, it's going to be in the form of a flannel sheet like this here it was. And I've used this flannel sheet. It was just a single sheet, and I've used it for so many things. I've made rice packs out of it and all kinds of different things using this very same fabric. So I double it over. But the more it wraps, the more protection you're going to get. And that way, when you have them stored next to each other in your freezer, you know, if you've got it on a movable shelf, like in a chest freezer, this is how I've broke jars before, is when the jars are frozen, they're very fragile. And so you don't want them smacking against each other, because that will crack your jars. And I lost a couple of quarts of goat milk doing that. And that was really irritating. And so, plus the two jars. And so I do that, and I haven't had any problems now with my jars cracking. So here's a couple images here from the freezer. You can show one here. You can see I've got a bunch of turkey broth. Now you'll see a couple of jars that aren't wrapped. That was because those were ones I stuck in later, and I have them in between others that are wrapped up really well, so I didn't worry about that. Again, you know, when I move that shelf around, no issues. And here's another picture here of mostly my apple cider that I made up from last year, and I decided I didn't want to can it because I wanted to keep it raw, so I froze it instead into jars. And so I just wrap them up, and that's going to keep them from breaking. Normally, when I'm harvesting my rhubarb, I don't bring the big leaves in. I only brought these in so I could show you, first of all, just how massive these leaves are. Look at these things. They're huge. So anyway, what I typically do is I will snap the leaf off outside, and then I'll just throw it on the ground next to the other plants and then let the leaf break down and feed the soil, because and it will also add a little ground covering too. And then the other thing you can do with the leaves, obviously you can't eat them. They're toxic to humans to eat these leaves, and they're also toxic to certain insects. So I've used rhubarb leaf along with some other herbs to make my own bug spray to spray directly on certain plants so that are growing. Ones that I'm not gonna, like I wouldn't spray it on my lettuce unless I'm gonna rinse it off really well, but like on my pepper plants, usually are the ones I have a problem with certain bugs getting at, and I'll just keep spraying that down, and that keeps the bugs off. So that's one of the things you can do with your rhubarb leaf if you're not gonna just throw it down for a ground cover and compost. So I'll snap the rest of these leaves off, get them out of my way. Yes, I still have a ton more of rhubarb to work through. Now, the other thing you can do with your rhubarb is dehydrate it. Now, this is actually from 2013, because I haven't dried dehydrated any since, because I wasn't crazy about it until I finally worked with some of it last year. Because, you know, you can use it in teas if you don't mind that tart flavor. I don't really like a tart flavor in my herbal infusions. So I wasn't crazy about that, but it is a good way to get more vitamin C. You can also use it to make like a vitamin tincture or something like that. However, it cooks up beautifully. So I'm going to start using the dehydrated rhubarb when I'm making pie, since it's something I have to cook anyway. And so what you would do then was just soak it for a little bit and then throw it in with the rest of your fruit, whether it be blueberry, which is the thing I usually like to mix it with, strawberry, whatever berry you're going to do. My favorite actually is to do blueberry, currant, and rhubarb. And so anyway, the liquid, the juices from the fruit will also help to cook that rhubarb, and so that works really good. You can still use your frozen rhubarb. I've done that as well. So with so much more rhubarb coming in this year than any other year, I am going to be dehydrating up a bunch, because it will take up less room in storage, and it will last for a very, very long time. I don't have to worry about it taking up space in my freezer either. So like I said, this is from 2013. Now, when I first dehydrated the rhubarb, I tried it two different methods. I tried doing the blanching method first, which I hated. It was very, very messy. Even though I followed the directions, I found just cutting it up and throwing it on the dehydrator trays and dehydrating it like that was much cleaner and worked out a lot better and was easier all the way around, because, well, it's saving you a step. So I recommend, when you're chopping your rhubarb for dehydrating, I recommend cutting it a little bit thinner than I did there for what I was freezing. But because that stuff's going to get all blended up anyway, I don't care the size, but especially if you're going to be putting it in pies, you might not want to have really big chunks. And then just take it and throw it right on my rack like that. And of course I'll spread it out. And then I don't remember how long it takes for it to dehydrate. I'm guessing I can have it done in a day. And as you can see, I've got the cloth on here. I came up with this method. It has two purposes. One is it prevents so much plastic exposure to my food, my herbs, whatever I'm dehydrating, as well as when I'm doing herbs like thyme, things that are really tiny, it prevents anything from falling through the rack to the ones down below. And so it just keeps it all contained. And I'm loving this method. I find my stuff dehydrates much quicker using the cloth fabric, especially than adding those clean-a-screens or anything else, because it allows for a lot more airflow. Now, for the dehydrating temperature, if you have, which I recommend, if you're getting a dehydrator, you don't have one yet, find one with a temperature gauge. I mean, one that you can actually adjust the temperature. Some of the older models don't have that, and I was surprised when I found that out. But when I dehydrate the rhubarb, I'm going to go 115 degrees on that. You could safely go a little bit higher, but I'm finding that 115 is, unless you're doing meat, 115 is the top degree you should set when you're doing fruits, vegetables, and then herbs should be a little lower, like 105 is a good temperature for herbs, but you can go lower than that, like as low as 95. Now, a lot of people ask me, well, how long does it take to dehydrate? It's going to depend on your dehydrator. It's going to depend on how much stuff you have on there. It's going to depend on your heat setting. And even sometimes your climate and how humid the inside of your house is or wherever it is you're setting it, that can actually play a lot into how fast your stuff's going to dehydrate. So I can't tell you exact times. What I can tell you, though, is you should be checking your stuff every couple of hours to see how it's coming along. You will start to get familiar the more you dehydrate with how fast certain things are going to dehydrate. And everything's going to be different. And again, you can be surprised. Something you might think, like woolly lamb's ear, for instance, is a very thick, fuzzy leaf. You would think that it would take a long time to dehydrate, but I find it dehydrates up quicker than other herbs that are much thinner than that. So you have to keep up on it and just check. And then once you're, like you can see, I didn't even bother putting the band on this one. It's been vacuum sealed in this jar since 2013. And totally sealed, no problem. So do just like I did with the freezer one. I use the brake bleeder and the vacuum sealer tops. If you can find them, they've been hard to find lately, but they do keep trying to restock them. The price has gone up, but they're worth it. So, I mean, I've even considered getting another backup set someday just to have them on hand. But anyway, I've been using the same sets for years. Just vacuum seal it up just like I did. You can use your food saver, or you can simply do like I did with the brake bleeder there. So if you're interested in that, I do have a video just on using the brake bleeder. Another method you can look into is canning your rhubarb. I haven't personally tried that yet because the way I like to get my rhubarb coming in, I don't have enough at one time to fill up my canner. And the way I like to use my rhubarb, I prefer to have it fresh and as fresh and raw as possible for a lot of the things I'm using it in, unless I'm making jam or pie. And that's the other thing, the dehydrated rhubarb works really good for jam making. So that's the other thing I was going to say. So that's what I plan on doing. A lot of times, though, the things that I'm going to make jam with, like the salmon berries, rhubarb salmon berry jam is really good. We have salmon berries that grow out on our other piece of property, and so again, I'll be going out and gathering some this year and making some more salmon berry rhubarb jam, because that turned out really good. And I have a recipe on that I'll link to down below if you're interested. And if you have salmon berries that grow around you, I do recommend combining it with rhubarb or some other fruit, because salmon berries don't have the kind of flavor that other berries have. Since the rhubarb comes in first, it just makes sense for me to either freeze it or dehydrate it. Then when my other fruit comes in, then I can add it into whatever it is. We're not the kind of people that like rhubarb by itself, like rhubarb pie or rhubarb jam. It has to be mixed with something else for us to be able to enjoy it. So that's why I do one of these two methods, particularly the freezing. It's just not worth it for me to spend the time and the fuel canning up the rhubarb if I'm going to turn around and open it right back up again to mix it with other fruit. However, that might be a method for you. If you like just plain rhubarb pie, then you can up your rhubarb. You've got it ready to throw into a pie. Now, if you're interested in canning rhubarb, I recommend you look it up for yourself. You can find recipes online. I'm sure there's YouTube videos out there. Just do a search on YouTube or in your browser for how to can rhubarb if you're interested in doing it that way. But for me, I'm going to be sticking with the freezing and the dehydrating. I love canning, but for me, it's just not something I like to use for everything. And dehydrating is great because it takes up so much less room. And freezing is simple because you can just do a jar or two at a time. You don't have to worry about having enough to fill your whole canner all at once. Okay, well, I hope you enjoyed this video and it gives you some ideas of how to put your rhubarb up for the rest of the year. All right, well, thanks for watching. Take care and God bless.